Yes, I'm speaking on the meaning of particle indistinguishability. Well, I've got a new in there because this is a set of ideas that's been developed over the last 20 years or so. I suppose mostly by me and my collaborators and also some others. Whether they are genuinely new or not is usually for you to judge, perhaps. You'll see near the end. I realise it's totally late and we're all very tired, so I've made my talk, I knew this was coming, so I made my talk as colourful as possible. So I hope that's all right. So let me start, and I should announce right at the beginning that I'm so sorry, I find this distracting. So I should say at the beginning that the overall message is that Gibbs paradox is being ignored. To a great detriment of our understanding of particle indistinguishability in quantum mechanics. And that applies not only to our contemporary understanding, but to the history of development of the subject. And if I just may make a point, the name Gibbs has been mentioned only once today, and that was in reference to a question and probably in the center of the talk. So I think it rather proves the case, really, that Gibbs has been ignored in this history. We've had two very interesting talks on particle indistinguishability, but Gibbs just did not come up. Anyway, so let me just review Gibbs' paradox. So this is the name given to it by Pierre Duhem in 1892 or something like that. I don't think Gibbs ever used the word paradox. But so you've got two containers, and they're at the same temperature and pressure. In the one case, there's different particles in the two containers, in the other case, they're the same. Now, when they're different, we straightforwardly have entropy increase, and it comes when the partition is removed and the two samples mix. And there's two sources for that. One is type 1, particle numbers in the two chambers may change. Now, actually, that, in the case of equal pressures and temperatures, is entirely negligible in the thermodynamic limit and vanishes in the Stirling approximation. Type 2 concerns the question of which particle is in which chamber. So that can change. A particle initially in chamber A could end up in chamber B. So anyway, that's when we have no doubt about it, entropy of mixing when the two substances are different, but what happens when the substances are the same? So the type 1 entropy increase remains, but as I said, in the thermodynamic limit, it's negligible. So the real issue is this type 2. Okay, so I'm going to discuss this for the next 5 minutes or so, and then look at commentators on particle indistinguishability, mostly post-war, really to demonstrate the not so much the neglect, because these are commentators who do talk about Gibbs, but what I think is a misunderstanding of what Gibbs proposed. Okay, and so throughout also, I'll be thinking of the entropy as the Boltzmann entropy, K log W. W is the accessible phase space volume, also called thermodynamic probability. I am somewhat skeptical that probability is the right term for it, but that may come to be relevant later on. Right, so I'm going to approach this issue, whether or not when the substances are the same, is there an entropy of mixing, through a very realistic I'm looking at the microphysics of a concrete example of two samples of a gas, the same type of gas, that are mixing. And to that end, I've drawn a space-time diagram. I've only got three particles in chamber A and four in chamber B, so I'm not exactly in the thermodynamic limit. But I've considered a situation where when the partition is removed, that's the, here, the partition just vanishes abruptly, where we've ended up with exactly the same number as we started off with, three here, three, four here, four here. That's without the partition, but with the partition, sorry, that's with the partition. With the partition removed, we've still got three here, still got four there. And it's a space-time diagram, so you can look at the velocities from the angles intended. And the velocities are all the same, the positions are all the same. The only issue is which particle has which position and velocity. Okay, and I just want to note that at time t2, with the partition in place throughout, there's no question of any entropy of mixing. The entropy hasn't changed. Now, let's re-establish this situation with this sample of gas by performing a switch. So what I'm doing in the switch is I'm just taking all of the A particles that came from the A side and making sure that they end up back in the A side, and the particles in the B side making sure they end up back in the B side. And if indeed the state here, this is the way I'm going to frame the paradox, if the state here is the same as the state here, then there's no entropy of mixing. Right, and I've just got a little bit of a close-up. I'm phrasing my question now, are the two states, and now I've got T2 and T3, are these two states the same? Right, well, now we've got it down to, I think, only, what, seven particles in total. Let's go even more simplified. Let's go down to two particles. So this is the Gibbs paradox of two particles. So can the state of two things be unchanged when the state of each thing has changed? So in other words, can we regard the state here at T2 as identically the same as the state here at T2, even though the particles have changed places with one another? And let me just put it nicely, sort of cartoon. So what happened? Is the state now the same as what it was before, or has the state changed? Okay, so Gibbs' solution in the final chapter of his book, Elementary Principles of Mechanics, of System Mechanics in 1902, was that indeed the states are identically the same because they only differ through a permutation. And he proposed to identify points of phase space that differ only in which particle has which position and momentum. That those points should be identified. He used the terminology generic phase and specific phase. And another way of framing it, take the equivalence class of specific phases that are related by permutations to represent the generic phase. And say it again, there are n factorial specific phase space points for each generic phase space point. And that's going to impact on the volume measure on phase space. Okay, so this seems to me eminently reasonable proposal and entirely clear and without paradox or whatever, but that isn't how it was received. So the idea was either ignored or dismissed as unintelligible. These are all quotes from people. Unintelligible, mystical, nonsensical, instrumentalist, the work of an old man in rapidly fading health. That's E.T. James. And I must say, I did take exception to that. I mean, Gibbs was only 62. Anyway, he was quite relatively young, and he wasn't ailing then. He died the next year, but that was from a sudden and unexpected illness, so I think that's not really a very kind way of putting it. Okay, so we can frame the problem in natural language as well, and it has been done many times, every now and then anyway. I'm thinking of, I suppose, Hermann Weyl with some it's like this Schrodinger. So Daniela, I think, remarked on Schrodinger's book in 1950, where he tried to frame it in terms of natural language. So the right way to frame this in natural language is, so long as predicates about the past or future of the two bodies are excluded, and as long as proper names are excluded, then we cannot express in natural language the difference between what I showed you with the cartoon, where the two sort of mutate into one another. I mean, when the red square and the red circle are supposed to be identical substances, they don't differ in any way other than their shapes. So we've got a sort of linguistic test, and you just can't explain to somebody in what way is the state different in the two cases. And this connects with a very large background in philosophy. Just giving some examples: Leibniz's principle of identity and discernibles, Quine's ontological relativity, Putnam's model theory argument. So these are interesting philosophical debates that go on in philosophical logic, totally disconnected from this physics, but which could and can and have been connected, related to them. And I suspect rather it's because of this philosophical background that people have been deeply suspicious of Gibbs, this proposal of Gibbs. Or at least that is my attempt to understand quite why it has been so viewed with such skepticism. Okay, so, well, this is indistinguishability in natural language. These constraints look rather artificial. Why exclude past and future? But think of what a state space is in physics. So a state space where you've got a dynamic evolution operator, you can't build into the points of space, phase space, their distance. When you specify the state of a system where you've got a dynamic acting, the state does not contain within it its own history or future. It's the Hamiltonian, the dynamics that will determine whatever its past or future. And the business about not using proper names translates very easily and quickly over into don't label these particles, and that actually amounts to them using a specific phase. So there's a fairly direct connection. So let me just revisit this in terms of the Gibbs paradox, looking just at indistinguishability in terms of phase-space points. So we have the Boltzmann entropy. I'm neglecting the momentum contribution because this is isothermal, same pressure and so forth. So really it's only the volume dependence that matters, and there it is. The two samples of the same substance prior to the partition being removed, this is entropy S1, entropy S2, we add them because entropy is additive for independent systems. We get the expression that immediately follows. Now you remove the partition, and now this is the new Boltzmann entropy. And the point is that these things are not equal. So that's the fundamental problem, as it were. Why it seems there ought to be an entropy of mixing. So, and relatedly, if you look at representative points in these two phase spaces, they're n-tuples. They're ordered n-tuples, n-tuples in one case. And then when they're combined, you get an even longer ordered n plus m. Okay, now go to the indistinguishable particles and follow what Gibbs said. Identify specific phases, n factorial of them, to get the generic phase. So now the entropy is divided by n factorial. So that's fine. And now we repeat the same calculations as before, except with this n factorial. You see the differences before you, and now observe this wonderful approximate equality. So it's approximate, it's equality in the Stirling approximation, but the Stirling approximation is an approximation. So why is it approximate? Answer, because there's still type 1 entropy increase. With the partition removed, you can have different numbers of particles on the two sides. And that is the only reason why it's approximate. If you were to remove that, then it would be exact. And then if you look at the expressions for representative points in these phase space, often called reduced phase space, then we have not ordered n-tuples, we've got unordered collections of n-coordinates, and there's no permutations acting. So here's a way of expressing what's going on. Go to, we take up Gibbs' proposal, we unordered n-tuples replace ordered. Another word for this is due to Jeremy Butterfield, anti-factorism, this is in relation to some work about important work, and I think it's a useful slogan for what's going on. We are getting rid of what we build in by our mathematical notation, sequence position in an ordered n tuple. We just build that in. So here's how to build it out. Take the quotient under permutations, replace ordered n tuples by unordered n tuples. Okay, so now I want to just do this again, but with phase space discretized. Okay, and this is because both, this is what they did, this is what Boltzmann did, very nice Dr. Bandino's talk really illustrated some of this. So you discretize phase space, and in the distinguishable case, so we've got Z cells, and now we look at the number of states, number of ways of distributing the n particles over those Z cells. We're supposing we watch generously, so it's not an issue that's right here. So take a set of occupation numbers for those cells, then you get this factor for the number of different ways that those n particles can be distributed over the Z cells so as to give you those occupation numbers. But then you've got to sum over all possible occupation numbers where they all have to sum to n. So that's fine. Now do the same for indistinguishable particles, again Z cells, and now we have the Boltzmann expression, and we saw that with Dr. Monaldi. And I learned something from this talk that I haven't learned before, and I don't have to think about this, and this relates to Boltzmann's paper, it was a 1969 very early paper. I didn't know that Boltzmann was using probabilistic ideas as early as that. Anyway, so this is something for you to think about. But in terms of what this thing means, the straightforward interpretation is that this is replaced by 1. There it is, I get 1. And because there's no difference for commuting these particles and numbers, you're not changing them. And so the only issue is the sum over all the occupation numbers. And there it is. That's what this expression is. It's called the Boltzmann expression because it was lifted, well, it was found in Boltzmann's writings and Plum lifted it, I think it was 1900. It was in an act of desperation, as I read Plum. He talks about this as the most intensive weeks of my life, you know, sort of working away the track. What he'd done, he knew he had the right distribution. The experimental data was confirming it. He'd interpolated between the Wien and Raleigh genes distribution for black body radiation. So he knew he'd got something right, but he didn't know what it meant. So using manipulations that he'd used before, just 3 or 4 years before, with the Wien law, he worked out what the entropy was corresponding to the Plum distribution. And then he had to figure out, well, how would one arrive at that entropy? And it was then that he turned to Boltzmann's probabilistic ideas that he was resisted, and he found this expression in Boltzmann, and then he found that the logarithm of that approximated the expression he got, reverse engineering in the Plum distribution. Okay, so it's, I also call it the Boltzmann expression because, of course, nobody really knew what this meant at the time. The simple analysis I've just given seemed to be problematic, which I find extraordinary. So the sort of evidence I have that this was puzzling to people isn't only that nobody really quite makes sense of what I could have done, but Aaron Fest and Kamalenko Arms gave a derivation of this, you know, with great sort of deep to themselves. They also call it a joke. So it's quite interesting, actually. What is the significance of this? This was in the back. Anyway, okay, good, good. Now, this is something that I had not been able to find in any of the relevant papers at the time, which is extraordinary. Because it's extremely important. It follows very easily, but maybe not easily enough for it to be just self-evident. But anyway, it's what, of course, gives you agreement with the Gibbs entropy for the continuum case. And of course it must do, because the continuum limit, when the number of cells is much greater than the number of particles, you can always do that in a continuum case. You can take Z to be infinite. So you should always get over to this expression in the continuum. Okay, good. Now let's look at the same ideas more visually. So this is the phase space for two distinguishable particles. So one particle has the phase space gamma 1, the other gamma 2. I'm imagining some property A and B, so we can speak about one particle, has it got A or has it got B, the other particle has it got A or has it got B. So a point here will tell you not just how many, you know, are there two A's or two B's or one A and B, but also in the case of one A and B, which has A and which has B. So that's fine. And if you think in terms of probability, and you're thinking that this is something like throwing a dice, you know, A is heads, B is tails, so you get the probability for an A and a B is this volume plus that volume. So it's twice the probability of two B's or the probability of two A's. So very straightforward and simple. Okay, and here's a switch of the sort that I was talking about before. Okay, and clearly the switch for distinguishable particles, it takes you from one point to a different point in phase space, which just consists of switching over Q2 goes to Q1, Q1 to Q2. Okay, everything's straightforward. Now let's go to the indistinguishable case, classical. So, and again, I find this absolutely extraordinary that so far as I know, well, I don't know if this is true, but I think it was Nick Huggett in 1999 who pointed out that the probability of an A and a B remains twice the probability of two A's or two B's. Well, look, I'm sure this is my limitation. I mean, this is just a philosopher speaking. Physicists must have been obvious to them for decades and so on and so forth. But I wasn't the only one to be struck by Nick's observation. David Albert was also struck by it. So no change to the probabilities. You've still got the probability of a head and a tail is twice what it is for two heads and two tails. Okay, good. Now, the switch. Well, of course, the switch just does this. Everything's totally physical, everything's completely well defined. It's just you're not saying which is which, such that you can make sense of the question which one is Q1 and which one is Q2. It's just two particles, Q1 and Q2. But it's physically entirely realistic. Okay, so now quantum mechanics. What is the magic of quantum mechanics? Well, there's many, many bits to that. But the point that we need is just that the volume measure is being replaced by a discrete count of dimensionality. So we're looking at a finite volume system with a bound on the energy, so the whole space is finite. So what is the appropriate probability measure, or the volume measure, if you like, state space measure, answer count of dimensionality? But in the case of distinguishable particles, it just doesn't make any difference. Each of these, you just count the number to get the, if you do the point or some business, get the probability. And you've just got, there's still two ways of having an A and a B, and one way of having two A's and one way of having two B's. So no change there. So now though, look what happens when you go to the distinguishable, it's quotient of by two. And now the point about the volume measure, we're not looking at the areas here, each area is half this one, we're just counting dimensionality. We've got a three-dimensional space, and now the probability of a head and a tail is one-third, probability of two heads is one-third, probability of two tails is one-third. So this is the distinctive Bose-Einstein statistics. Okay, I won't bother to put in the switch. The switch acts exactly as before. It's just going to be an orbit in the space that goes back to where it came from. To get, what happens when we go to a greater number of dimensions in the orbit space corresponding to property A and property B? So I've been rather lazy, sorry, and I haven't put lots of red dots in place of the squares, but the thing is, just count the squares and that gives you the orbit space measure. And the point is that it's only the only difference, really, in terms of ratios. The only difference concerns the diagonal, and that becomes completely irrelevant as the dimensionality of the Hilbert space goes up. So you recover the same probabilities as distinguishable particles, you've got the classical limit. Okay, so expressed in terms of quantum states, I think we have this notation, and it's very obvious that permutation of 1 and 2 won't change anything. And we also, in the free case, can have a unitary evolution which preserves does not lead to superpositions of such states. So in this way, symmetrization implements anti-factorism, and it permits an interpretation in terms of trajectories. So I can equally talk of the unordered pair of states, each trajectory, or I can speak of this thing. Okay, fine. Okay, let me label that with a symbol, and next point I want to make is that entangled states produced in this way are trivial. And this is Gerardi, Marinotto, and Weber. You can't violate Bell inequality with them, for example, so that's important. Okay, so this is the set of ideas that I wanted to present to you, and I think you need them all in order for to settle on any one or two of them. I don't think you need all of these ideas in place. Now, I'm aware that I'm running out of time. I think I've only got a few minutes left. Is that correct? I was very fierce when I was chairing, so I expect you to. So let me just quickly run through some comments of people. This is Schrodinger. Apparently, Gibbs' paradox needs quantum mechanics to resolve it. This is Stern. You can't solve the n factorial problem in classical mechanics. This is Huang's textbook. You can't solve it without n factorial. And so forth. I'm going to have to go through this very carefully. Abraham Pice. He's making the same point. Boltzmann, you can track the particles as they move around, so you don't have any problem with indistinguishability, but it's got nothing to do with tracking. You can track the particles. The question is, have you returned to the same state when you interchange them all? So here's Nico van Kampen. It's impossible to justify the n factorial as you restrict yourself to a closed system, and so forth. I'm going to have to go through all of these. David Albert, all saying the same thing, and this is my evidence that this has been neglected or wholly misunderstood. Now what I want to do is quickly conclude, though, going further back in time, pre-war, everyone else I've been looking at was post-war, and particularly a commentary on Gibbs' scientific writings in two volumes from Yale University Press in 1934. Now, heavens. If anybody was to make a connection between Gibbs' treatment of indistinguishability and the quantum mechanical treatment made evident in Dirac, 1926, it should have been in this book. Paul Epstein has two chapters in the book on Gibbs' statistics. He does not make this connection. No connection at all with quantum statistics. I take that as very significant. Now, go to Bose. I'm sure many of us here who've studied Bose have been mystified. How is it this person achieved an extraordinary thing, apparently by mistake? But he didn't do it. He did one thing right, an extraordinary thing that he did right. He thought that photons could have trajectories. I don't just mean a line. I mean that a photon could have a state space of its own. And if you think what photons began with in Planck as energy elements, or even Einstein in 1905, the idea of an energy element having a state space is nonsensical. So this was Bose's great achievement. I know, going now, and I'm really nearly done. So we come back to Einstein. Now, Einstein, he didn't have all of the bits have been dropping off. This bit dropped off, this bit dropped off. And he didn't have the photons having trajectories either. And he didn't even have this. He wasn't looking at quantum statistics in terms of finiteness of state space. He was looking at explanation of classical statistics of the radiation field in terms of particles. And what did he do? Well, he didn't have any, he knew about Gibbs. Gibbs was translated in 1904. But nobody took any notice of it, apparently. What was Einstein doing? He was looking at the Wien distribution law, here it is, and what he called here the law of black bodies, comes from the thermodynamics. And he had his beautiful, elegant, wonderful fluctuation arguments, that the fluctuation formula for indistinguishable classical particles in subvolume V of volume V0 is this thing, which is the same as you get by reverse engineering to get the entropy from the Wien law. Now do that with indistinguishable particles using the 1.n factorial, you'll get exactly the same. Well, this seems really, you know, being concealed. But look, do it not in the Wien limit, do it using the full combinatoric expression and reverse engineer from the Planck distribution, and that's what you get. In other words, if Einstein had used the Planck distribution and read Gibbs, he would have immediately been led to the photon picture. Of course he was not, because he thought only in the Wien limit did radiation have particular characteristics. But he would instead have concluded that across all of the frequency distributed spectrum, particles are indistinguishable. Okay, that's the right conclusion, and this is my thanks. Start off with n1 particles here, n2 there. You remove the partition, you could end up with a different number here and a different number there.